Gabriel Conroy. By Bret Harte. Podcast 6 of 16. Book 3. The Lead. Chapter 5. In which the Donna Maria makes an impression. The Rancho of the Blessed Fisherman looked seaward, as became its title. If the founder of the rancho had shown a religious taste in the selection of the site of the dwelling, his charming widow had certainly shown equal practical taste, and indeed a profitable availing of some advantages that the founder did not contemplate, in the adornment of the house. The low-walled square adobe dwelling had been relieved of much of its hard practical outline by several feminine additions and suggestions. The tiled roof had been carried over a very broad veranda, supported by vine-clad columns, and the lounging corridor had been, in defiance of all Spanish custom, transferred from the inside of the house to the outside. The interior courtyard no longer existed. The somberness of the heavy Mexican architecture was relieved by bright French chintzes, delicate lace curtains, and fresh-colored hangings. The broad veranda was filled with the latest novelties of Chinese bamboo chairs and sets, and a striped Venetian awning shaded the glare of the seaward front. Nevertheless, Donna Maria, out of respect to the local opinion, which regarded these changes as ominous of, if not a symbolical putting off the weeds of widowhood, still clung to a few of the local traditions. It is true that a piano occupied one side of her drawing room, but a harp stood in the corner. If a freshly cut novel lay open on the piano, a breviary was conspicuous on the marble center table. If, on the mantel, an elaborate French clock with bronze shepherdesses trifled with time, on the wall above it an iron crucifix spoke of eternity. Mrs. Sepulveda was at home that morning expecting a guest. She was lying in a manila hammock, swung between two posts of the veranda, with her face partially hidden by the netting, and the toe of a little shoe just peeping beyond. Not that Donna Maria expected to receive her guest thus; on the contrary, she had given orders to her servants that the moment a stranger caballero appeared on the road she was to be apprised of the fact. For I grieve to say that, far from taking Arthur's advice, the details of the adventure at the Point of Pines had been imparted by her own lips to most of her female friends, and even to the domestics of her household. In the earlier stages of a woman's interest in a man she is apt to be exceedingly communicative; it is only when she becomes fully aware of the gravity of the stake involved that she begins to hedge before the public. The morning after her adventure Donna Maria was innocently full of its hero and unreservedly voluble. I have forgotten whether I have described her. Certainly I could not have a better opportunity than the present. In the hammock she looked a little smaller, as women are apt to when their length is rigidly defined. She had the average quantity of brown hair, a little badly treated by her habit of wearing it flat over her temples, a tradition of her boarding school days, 15 years ago. She had soft brown eyes, with a slight redness of the eyelid not inconsistent nor entirely unbecoming to widowhood, a small mouth depressed at the corners with a charming, childlike discontent, white regular teeth, and the eloquence of a complexion that followed unvaryingly the spirits of her physical condition. She appeared to be about 30, and had that unmistakable married look which even the most amiable and considerate of us, my dear sir, are apt to impress upon the one woman whom we choose to elect to years of exclusive intimacy and attention. The late Don José Sepulveda's private mark, as well defined as the brand upon his cattle, was a certain rigid line, like a grave accent, from the angle of this little woman's nostril to the corners of her mouth, and possibly to an increased peevishness of depression at those corners. It bore witness to the fondness of the deceased for bear-baiting and bullfighting, and a possible weakness for a certain Señora X of San Francisco, whose reputation was none of the best, and was not increased by her distance from San Antonio and the surveillance of Donna Maria. When an hour later Pepe appeared to his mistress, bearing a salver with Arthur Poinsett's business card and a formal request for an interview, I am afraid Donna Maria was a little disappointed. If he had suddenly scaled the veranda, evaded her servants, and appeared before her in an impulsive, forgivable way, it would have seemed consistent with his character as a hero, and perhaps more in keeping with the general tenor of her reveries when the servitor entered. Howbeit, after heaving an impatient little sigh, and bidding Pepe show the gentleman into the drawing room, She slipped quietly down from the hammock in a deft womanish way, and whisked herself into her dressing room. He couldn't have been more formal if Don Jose had been alive, she said to herself as she walked to her glass and dressing table. Arthur Poinsett entered the vacant drawing room not in the best of his many humors. He had read in the eyes of the lounging vaqueros, in the covert glances of the women servants, that the story of his adventure was known to the household. Habitually petted and spoiled as he had been by the women of his acquaintance, he was half inclined to attribute this reference and assignment of his client's business to the hands of Mrs. Sepulveda, as the result of a plan of Father Felipe's, or absolute collusion between the parties. A little sore yet, and irritated by his recollection of the Padre's counsel, and more impatient of the imputation of a weakness than anything else, Arthur had resolved to limit the interview to the practical business on hand, and in so doing had, for a moment, I fear, forgotten his native courtesy. It did not tend to lessen his irritation and self-consciousness when Mrs. Sepulveda entered the room without the slightest evidence of her recent disappointment visible in her perfectly easy, frank self-possession, and after a conventional, half-Spanish solicitousness regarding his health since their last interview, without any further allusions to their adventure, begged him to be seated. She herself took an easy chair on the opposite of the table, and assumed at once an air of respectful but somewhat indifferent attention. "I believe," said Arthur, plunging at once into his subject to get rid of his embarrassment and the slight instinct of antagonism he was beginning to feel toward the woman before him, "I believe that is, I am told that besides your own business, you are interested with some documents and facts regarding a claim of the Donna Dolores Salvatierra. Which shall we have first? I am entirely at your service for the next 2 hours, but we shall proceed faster and with less confusion by taking up one thing at a time." "Then let us begin with Donna Dolores, by all means," said Donna Maria, "my own affairs can wait. Indeed," she added, languidly, "I dare say one of your clerks could attend to it as well as yourself. If your time is valuable as indeed it must be, I can put the papers in his hands and make him listen to all my foolish, irrelevant talk. He can sift it for you, Don Arturo. I really am a child about business, really." Arthur smiled, and made a slight gesture of deprecation. In spite of his previous resolution, Donna Maria's tone of slight pique pleased him. Yet he gravely opened his notebook, and took up his pencil without a word. Donna Maria observed the movements, and said more seriously, "Ah yes, how foolish. Here I am talking about my own affairs, when I should be speaking of Donna Dolores. Well, to begin, let me first explain why she has put this matter in my hands. My husband and her father were friends, and had many business interests in common. As you have doubtless heard, she has always been very quiet, very reserved, very religious, almost a nun. I dare say she was driven into this isolation by reason of the delicacy of her position here, for you know, do you not, that her mother was an Indian. It is only a few years ago that the old governor, becoming a widower and childless, bethought himself of this Indian child, Dolores. He found the mother dead, and the girl living somewhere at a distant mission as an acolyte. He brought her to San Antonio, had her christened, and made legally his daughter and heiress. She was a mere slip of a thing, about 14 or 15. She might have had a pretty complexion, for some of these half-breeds are nearly white, but she had been stained when an infant with some barbarous and indelible dye, after the savage custom of her race. She is now a light copper color, not unlike those bronze shepherdesses on yonder clock. In spite of all this, I call her pretty. Perhaps it is because I love her and am prejudiced. But you gentlemen are so critical about complexion and color, no wonder that the poor child refuses to see anybody, and never goes into society at all. It is a shame. But pardon, Mr. Poinsett, here am I gossiping about your client's looks, when I should be stating her grievances." "No, no," said Arthur, hastily, "go on in your own way." Mrs. Sepulveda lifted her forefinger archly. "Ah, is it so, Don Arturo? I thought so. Well, "It is a great shame that she is not here for you to judge for yourself." Angry with himself for his embarrassment, and for the rising color on his cheek, Arthur would have explained himself, but the lady, with feminine tact, did not permit him to proceed, partly because I did not participate in the prejudices with which the old families here regarded her race and color, partly, perhaps, because we were both strangers here, we became friends. At first she resisted all my advances, indeed, I think she was more shy of me than the others, but I triumphed in time, and we became good friends. Friends, you understand, Mr. Poinsett, not confidants. You men, I know, deem this impossible, but Donna Dolores is a singular girl, and I have never, except upon the most general topics, won her from her habitual reserve. And I possess perhaps her only friendship. Except Father Felipe, her confessor. Mrs. Sepulveda shrugged her shoulders, and then borrowed the habitual sceptical formula of San Antonio. Quien sabe? But I am rambling again. Now for the case. She rose, and taking from the drawer of the secretary an envelope, drew out some papers it contained, and referred to them as she went on. It appears that a grant of Micheltorena to Salvatierra was discovered recently at Monterey, a grant of which there was no record among Salvatierra's papers. The explanation given is that it was placed some 5 years ago in trust with a Don Pedro Ruiz, of San Francisco as security for a lease now expired. The grant is apparently regular, properly witnessed, and attested. Don Pedro has written that some of the witnesses are still alive, and remember it. Then why not make the proper application for a patent? True, but if that were all, Don Arturo would not have been summoned from San Francisco for consultation. There is something else. Don Pedro writes that another grant for the same land has been discovered recorded to another party. That is, I am sorry to say, not a singular experience in our profession, said Arthur, with a smile. But Salvatierra's known reputation and probity would probably be sufficient to outweigh equal documentary evidence on the other side. It's unfortunate he's dead, and the grant was discovered after his death. But the holder of the other grant is dead too, said the widow. That makes it about equal again. But who is he? Mrs. Sepulveda referred to her papers, and then said. Dr. Davarages. Who? Davarages, said Mrs. Sepulveda, referring to her notes. A singular name, a foreigner, I suppose. No, really, Mr. Poinsett, you shall not look at the paper until I have copied it. It's written horribly, you can't understand it. I'm really ashamed of my writing, but I was in such a hurry, expecting you every moment. Why, La? Mr. Poinsett, how cold your hands are. Arthur Poinsett had risen hurriedly, and reached out almost brusquely for the paper that she held. But the widow had coquettishly resisted him with a mischievous show of force, and had caught and dropped his hand. And you are pale, too. Dear me. I'm afraid you took cold that morning, said Mrs. Sepulveda. I should never forgive myself if you did. I should cry my eyes out, and Donna Maria cast a dangerous look from under her slightly swollen lids that looked as if they might threaten a deluge. Nothing, nothing, I have ridden far this morning, and rose early, said Arthur, chafing his hands with a slightly embarrassed smile. But I interrupted you. Pray go on. Has Dr. Davarages any heirs to contest the grant? But the widow did not seem inclined to go on. She was positive that Arthur wanted some wine. Would he not let her order some slight repast before they proceeded further in this horrid business? She was tired. She was quite sure that Arthur must be so too. It is my business, said Arthur, a little stiffly, but, recovering himself again in a sudden and new alarm of the widow, he smiled and suggested the sooner the business was over, the sooner he would be able to partake of her hospitality. The widow beamed prospectively. There are no heirs that we can find. But there is a what do you call it, a something or other in possession. A squatter, said Poinsett, shortly. Yes, continued the widow, with a light laugh, a squatter, by the name of my writing is so horrid, let me see, oh, yes. Gabriel Conroy. Arthur made an involuntary gesture toward the paper with his hand, but the widow mischievously skipped toward the window, and, luckily for the spectacle of his bloodless face, held the paper before her dimpled face and laughing eyes, as she did so. Gabriel Conroy, repeated Mrs. Sepulveda, and his. His sister, said Arthur, with an effort. No, sir, responded Mrs. Sepulveda, with a slight pout, his wife. Sister indeed. As if we married women are always to be ignored by you legal gentlemen. Arthur remained silent, with his face turned toward the sea. When he did speak his voice was quite natural. Might I change my mind regarding your offer of a moment ago, and take a glass of wine and a biscuit now? Mrs. Sepulveda ran to the door. Let me look over your notes while you are gone, said Arthur. You won't laugh at my writing. No. Donna Maria tossed him the envelope gaily and flew out of the room. Arthur hurried to the window with the coveted memoranda. There were the names she had given him but nothing more. At least this was some slight relief. The suddenness of the shock, rather than any moral sentiment or fear, had upset him. Like most imaginative men, he was a trifle superstitious, and with the first mention of DeVarge's name came a swift recollection of Padre Felipe's analysis of his own character, his sad, ominous reverie in the chapel, the trifling circumstance that brought him instead of his partner to San Antonio, and the remoter chance that had discovered the forgotten grant and selected him to prosecute its recovery. This conviction entertained and forgotten, all the resources of his combative nature returned. Of course he could not prosecute this claim, of course he ought to prevent others from doing it. There was every probability that the grant of DeVarge's was a true one and Gabriel was in possession. Had he really become DeVarge's heir, and if so, why had he not claimed the grant boldly? And where was Grace? In this last question there was a slight tinge of sentimental recollection, but no remorse or shame. That he might in some way be of service to her, he fervently hoped. That, time having blotted out the romantic quality of their early acquaintance, there would really be something fine and loyal in so doing, he did not for a moment doubt. He would suggest a compromise to his fair client, himself seek out and confer with Grace and Gabriel, and all should be made right. His nervousness and his agitation was, he was satisfied, only the result of a conscientiousness and a delicately honorable nature, perhaps too fine and spiritual for the exigencies of his profession. Of one thing he was convinced, he really ought to carefully consider Father Felipe's advice, he ought to put himself beyond the reach of these romantic relapses. In this self-sustained, self-satisfied mood, Mrs. Sepulveda found him on her return. Since she had been gone, he said, he had been able to see his way quite clearly into this case, and he had no doubt his perspicacity was greatly aided by the admirable manner in which she had indicated the various points on the paper she had given him. He was now ready to take up her own matters, only he begged as clear and concise a brief as she had already made for her friend. He was so cheerful and gallant that by the time luncheon was announced the widow found him quite charming, and was inclined to forgive him for the disappointment of the morning. And when, after luncheon, he challenged her to a sharp canter with him along the beach, by way, as he said, of keeping her memory from taking cold, and to satisfy herself that the point of pines could be doubled without going out to sea, I fear that, without a prudent consideration of the gossips of San Antonio before her eyes, she assented. There could be no harm in riding with her late husband's legal adviser, who had called, as everybody knew, on business, and whose time was so precious that he must return even before the business was concluded. And then Pepe could follow them, to return with her. It did not, of course, occur to either Arthur or Donna Maria that they might outrun Pepe, who was fat and indisposed to violent exertion, nor that they should find other things to talk about than the details of business, nor that the afternoon should be so marvelously beautiful as to cause them to frequently stop and admire the stretch of glittering sea beyond, nor that the roar of the waves was so deafening as to oblige them to keep so near each other for the purposes of conversation that the widow's soft breath was continually upon Arthur's cheek, nor that Donna Maria's saddle girth should become so loose that she was forced to dismount while Arthur tightened it, and that he should be obliged to lift her in his arms to restore her to her seat again. But finally, when the point of pines was safely rounded, and Arthur was delivering a few parting words of legal counsel, holding one of her hands in his, while with the other he was untwisting a long tress of her blown down hair, that, after buffeting his cheek into color, had suddenly twined itself around his neck, an old-fashioned family carriage, drawn by four black mules with silver harness, passed them suddenly on the road. Donna Maria drew her head and her hand away with a quick blush and laugh, and then gaily kissed her fingertips to the retreating carriage. Arthur laughed also but a little foolishly and looked as if expecting some explanation. "You should have your wits about you, sir. Did you know who that was?" Arthur sincerely confessed ignorance. He had not noticed the carriage until it had passed. "Think what you have lost. That was your fair young client." "I did not even see her," laughed Arthur. "But she saw you. She never took her eyes off you. Adios." Chapter 6. The Lady of Grief. "You will not go today," said Father Felipe to Arthur, as he entered the mission refectory early the next morning to breakfast. "I shall be on the road in an hour, Father," replied Arthur, gaily. "But not toward San Francisco," said the Padre. "Listen. Your wish of yesterday has been attained. You are to have your desired interview with the fair invisible. Do you comprehend? Donna Dolores has sent for you." Arthur looked up in surprise. Perhaps his face did not express as much pleasure as Father Felipe expected, who lifted his eyes to the ceiling, took a philosophical pinch of snuff, and muttered, "Ah, lo que es el mudo, now that he has his wish it is nothing, Mother of God. This is your kindness, Father." "God forbid," returned Padre Felipe, hastily. "Believe me, my son, I know nothing. When the Donna left here before the Angelus yesterday, she said nothing of this. Perhaps it is the office of your friend, Mrs. Sepulveda." "Hardly, I think," said Arthur. "She was so well prepared with all the facts as to render an interview with Donna Dolores unnecessary." "Bueno, be it so. I will go." Nevertheless, he was ill at ease. He ate little, he was silent. All the fears he had argued away with such self-satisfied logic the day before, returned to him again with greater anxiety. Could there have been any further facts regarding this inopportune grant that Mrs. Sepulveda had not disclosed? Was there any particular reason why this strange recluse, who had hitherto avoided his necessary professional presence, should now desire a personal interview which was not apparently necessary? Could it be possible that communication had already been established with Gabriel or Grace, and that the history of their previous life had become known to his client? Had his connection with it been in any way revealed to the Donna Dolores? If he had been able to contemplate this last possibility with calmness and courage yesterday when Mrs. Sepulveda first repeated the name of Gabriel Conroy, was he capable of equal resignation now? Had anything occurred since then, had any new resolution entered his head to which such a revelation would be fatal? Nonsense. And yet he could not help commenting, with more or less vague uneasiness of mind, on his chance meeting of Donna Dolores at the Point of Pines yesterday and the summons of this morning. Would not his foolish attitude with Donna Maria, aided, perhaps, by some indiscreet expression from the well-meaning but senile Padre Felipe, be sufficient to exasperate his fair client had she been cognizant of his first relations with Grace? It is not mean natures alone that are the most suspicious. A quick, generous imagination, feverishly excited, will project theories of character and intention far more ridiculous and uncomplimentary to humanity than the lowest surmises of ignorance and imbecility. Arthur was feverish and edited, with all the instincts of a contradictory nature, his easy sentimentalism dreaded, while his combative principles longed for, this interview. Within an hour of the time appointed by Donna Dolores, he had thrown himself on his horse, and was galloping furiously toward the Rancho of the Holy Trinity. It was inland and 3 leagues away under the foothills. But as he entered upon the level plain, unrelieved by any watercourse, and baked and cracked by the fierce sun into narrow gaping chasms and yawning fissures, he unconsciously began to slacken pace. Nothing could be more dreary, passionless, and resigned than the vast, sunlit, yet joyless waste. It seemed as if it might be some illimitable, desolate sea, beaten flat by the northwesterly gales that spent their impotent fury on its unopposing levels. As far as the eye could reach, its dead monotony was unbroken. Even the black cattle that in the clear distance seemed to crawl over its surface, did not animate it, rather by contrast brought into relief its fixed rigidity of outline. Neither wind, sky, nor sun wrought any change over its blank, expressionless face. It was the symbol of patience, a hopeless, weary, helpless patience, but a patience that was eternal. He had ridden for nearly an hour, when suddenly there seemed to spring up from the earth, a mile away, a dark line of wall, terminating in an irregular, broken outline against the sky. His first impression was that it was the Valda or a break of the stiff skirt of the mountain as it struck the level plain. But he presently saw the dull red of tiled roofs over the dark adobe wall, and as he dashed down into the dry bed of a vanished stream and up again on the opposite bank, he passed the low walls of a corral, until then unnoticed, and a few crows, in a rusty, half-Spanish, half-clerical suit, uttered a croaking welcome to the Rancho of the Holy Trinity, as they rose from the ground before him. It was the first sound that for an hour had interrupted the monotonous jingle of his spurs or the hollow beat of his horse's hoofs. And then, after the fashion of the country, he rose slightly in his stirrups, dashed his spurs into the sides of his mustang, swung the long, horsehair, braided thong of his bridle rein, and charged at headlong speed upon the dozen lounging, apparently listless vaqueros, who, for the past hour, had nevertheless been watching and waiting for him at the courtyard gate. As he rode toward them, they separated, drew up each side of the gate, doffed their glazed, stiff-brimmed, black sombreros, wheeled, put spurs to their horses, and in another instant were scattered to the four winds. When Arthur leaped to the brick pavement of the courtyard, there was not one in sight. An Indian servant noiselessly led away his horse. Another peon as mutely led the way along a corridor over whose low railing serapes and saddle blankets were hung in a barbaric confusion of coloring, and entered a bare-walled anteroom, where another Indian, old, gray-headed, with a face like a wrinkled tobacco leaf, was seated on a low wooden settle in an attitude of patient expectancy. To Arthur's active fancy he seemed to have been sitting there since the establishment of the mission, and to have grown gray in waiting for him. As Arthur entered he rose, and with a few grave Spanish courtesies, ushered him into a larger and more elaborately furnished apartment, and again retired with a bow. Familiar as Arthur was with these various formalities, at present they seemed to have an undue significance, and he turned somewhat impatiently as a door opened at the other end of the apartment. At the same moment a subtle strange perfume not unlike some barbaric spice or odorous Indian herb stole through the door, and an old woman, brown-faced, murky-eyed, and decrepit, entered with a respectful curtsy. "It is Don Arturo Poinsett." Arthur bowed. "The Donna Dolores has a little Indies position, and claims your indulgence if she receives you in her own room." Arthur bowed assent. "Bueno. This way." She pointed to the open door. Arthur entered by a narrow passage cut through the thickness of the adobe wall into another room beyond, and paused on the threshold. Even the gradual change from the glaring sunshine of the courtyard to the heavy shadows of the 2 rooms he had passed through was not sufficient to accustom his eyes to the twilight of the apartment he now entered. For several seconds he could not distinguish anything but a few dimly outlined objects. By degrees he saw that there were a bed, a prie-dieu, and a sofa against the opposite wall. The scant light of 2 windows, mere longitudinal slits in the deep walls, at first permitted him only this. Later he saw that the sofa was occupied by a half-reclining figure, whose face was partly hidden by a fan, and the white folds of whose skirt fell in graceful curves to the floor. "You speak Spanish, Don Arturo," said an exquisitely modulated voice from behind the fan, in perfect Castilian. Arthur turned quickly toward the voice with an indescribable thrill of pleasure in his nerves. A little. He was usually rather proud of his Spanish, but for once the conventional polite disclaimer was quite sincere. "Be seated, Don Arturo." He advanced to a chair indicated by the old woman within a few feet of the sofa and sat down. At the same instant the reclining figure, by a quick, dexterous movement, folded the large black fan that had partly hidden her features, and turned her face toward him. Arthur's heart leaped with a sudden throb, and then, as it seemed to him, for a few seconds stopped beating. The eyes that met his were large, lustrous, and singularly beautiful, the features were small, European, and perfectly modeled, the outline of the small face was a perfect oval, but the complexion was of burnished copper. Yet even the next moment he found himself halting among a dozen comparisons: a golden cherry, a faintly dyed meerschaum, an autumn leaf, the inner bark of the madrono. Of only one thing was he certain: she was the most beautiful woman he had ever seen. It is possible that the Donna read this in his eyes, for she opened her fan again quietly, and raised it slowly before her face. Arthur's eager glance swept down the long curves of her graceful figure to the little foot in the white satin slipper below. Yet her quaint dress, except for its color, might have been taken for a religious habit, and had a hood or cape descending over her shoulders not unlike a nun's. "You have surprise, Don Arturo," she said, after a pause, "that I have sent for you, after having before consulted you by proxy." "Good. But I have changed my mind since then. I have concluded to take no steps for the present toward perfecting the grant." In an instant Arthur was himself again and completely on his guard. The Donna's few words had recalled the past that he had been rapidly forgetting, even the perfectly delicious cadence of the tones in which it was uttered had now no power to fascinate him or lull his nervous anxiety. He felt a presentiment that the worst was coming. He turned toward her, outwardly calm, but alert, eager, and watchful. "Have you any newly discovered evidence that makes the issue doubtful?" he asked. "No," said Donna Dolores. "Is there anything, any fact that Mrs. Sepulveda has forgotten?" continued Arthur. "Here are, I believe, the points she gave me," he added, and, with the habit of a well-trained intelligence, he put before Donna Dolores, in a few well-chosen words, the substance of Mrs. Sepulveda's story. Nor did his manner in the least betray a fact of which he was perpetually cognizant, namely, that his fair client, between the sticks of her fan, was studying his face with more than feminine curiosity. When he paused she said, "Bueno. That is what I told her. Is there anything more?" "Perhaps." Arthur folded his arms and looked attentive. Donna Dolores began to go over the sticks of her fan one by one, as if it were a rosary. "I have become acquainted with some facts in this case which may not interest you as a lawyer, Don Arturo, but which affect me as a woman. When I have told you them, you will tell me, who knows, that they do not alter the legal aspect of my father's claim. You will perhaps laugh at me for my resolution. But I have given you so much trouble, that it is only fair you should know it is not merely caprice that governs me, that you should know why your visit here is a barren one, why you, the great advocate, have been obliged to waste your valuable time with my poor friend, Donna Maria, for nothing." Arthur was too much preoccupied to notice the peculiarly feminine significance with which the Donna dwelt upon this latter sentence, a fact that would not otherwise have escaped his keen observation. He slightly stroked his brown mustache, and looked out of the window with masculine patience. "It is not caprice, Don Arturo. But I am a woman and an orphan. You know my history. The only friend I had has left me here alone, the custodian of these vast estates. Listen to me, Don Arturo, and you will understand, or at least forgive, my foolish interest in the people who contest this claim. For what has happened to them, to her, might have happened to me, but for the Blessed Virgin's mediation." "To her, who is she?" asked Arthur, quietly. Pardon. I had forgotten you do not know. Listen. You have heard that this grant is occupied by a man and his wife, a certain Gabriel Conroy. Good. You have heard that they have made no claim to a legal title to the land, except through preemption. Good. That is not true, Don Arturo. Arthur turned to her in undisguised surprise. This is new matter, this is a legal point of some importance. Who knows, said Donna Dolores, indifferently. It is not in regard of that I speak. The claim is this. The Dr. Daveridges, who also possesses a grant for the same land, made a gift of it to the sister of this Gabriel. Do you comprehend? She paused, and fixed her eyes on Arthur. Perfectly, said Arthur, with his gaze still fixed on the window, it accounts for the presence of this Gabriel on the land. But is she living? Or, if not, is he her legally constituted heir? That is the question, and pardon me if I suggest again a purely legal and not a sentimental question. Was this woman who has disappeared this sister, this sole and only legatee, a married woman? Had she a child? Because that is the heir. The silence that followed this question was so protracted that Arthur turned towards Donna Dolores. She had apparently made some sign to her aged waiting woman, who was bending over her, between Arthur and the sofa. In a moment, however, the venerable handmaid withdrew, leaving them alone. You are right, Don Arturo, continued Donna Dolores, behind her fan. You see that, after all, your advice is necessary, and what I began as an explanation of my folly may be of business importance, who knows? It is good of you to recall me to that. We women are foolish. You are sagacious and prudent. It was well that I saw you. Arthur nodded assent, and resumed his professional attitude of patient toleration, that attitude which the world over has been at once the exasperation and awful admiration of the largely injured client. And the sister, the real heiress, is gone, disappeared. No one knows where. All trace of her is lost. But now comes to the surface an impostor. A woman who assumes the character and name of Grace Conroy, the sister. One moment, said Arthur, quietly, how do you know that it is an impostor? How do I know it? Yes, what are the proofs? I am told so. Oh, said Arthur, relapsing into his professional attitude again. Proofs, repeated Donna Dolores, hurriedly. Is it not enough that she has married this Gabriel, her brother? That is certainly strong moral proof and perhaps legal corroborative evidence, said Arthur, coolly, but it will not legally stop her proving that she is his sister if she can do so. But I ask your pardon, go on. That is all, said Donna Dolores, sitting up, with a slight gesture of impatience. Very well. Then, as I understand, the case is simply this: you hold a grant to a piece of land, actually possessed by a squatter, who claims it through his wife or sister legally, it doesn't matter which, by virtue of a bequest made by one Dr. Daveridges, who also held a grant to the same property. Yes, said Donna Dolores, hesitatingly. Well, the matter lies between you and Dr. Daveridges only. It is simply a question of the validity of the original grants. All that you have told me does not alter that radical fact. Stay. One moment. May I ask how you have acquired these later details? By letter. From whom? There was no signature. The writer offered to prove all he said. It was anonymous. Arthur rose with a superior smile. May I ask you further, without impertinence, if it is upon this evidence that you propose to abandon your claim to a valua? I have told you before that it is not a legal question, Don Arturo, said Donna Dolores, waving her fan a little more rapidly. Good, let us take it in the moral or sentimental aspect, since you have purposed to honor me with a request for my counsel. To begin, you have a sympathy for the orphan, who does not apparently exist. But her brother has already struck hands with the impostor, and married her to secure the claim. And this brother, what proof is there that he is not an impostor too? True, said Donna Dolores, musingly. He will certainly have to settle that trifling question with Dr. DeVarge's heirs, whoever they may be. True, said Donna Dolores. In short, I see no reason, even from your own viewpoint, why you should not fight this claim. The orphan you sympathize with is not an active party. You have only a brother opposed to you, who seems to have been willing to barter away a sister's birthright. And, as I said before, your sympathies, however kind and commendable they may be, will be of no avail unless the courts decide against Dr. DeVarge's. My advice is to fight. If the right does not always succeed, my experience is that the right, at least, is apt to play its best card, and put forward its best skill. And until it does that, it might as well be the wrong, you know. You are wise, Don Arturo. But you lawyers are so often only advocates. Pardon, I mean no wrong. But if it were Grace the sister, you understand what would be your advice. The same. Fight it out? If I could overthrow your grant, I should do it. The struggle, understand me, is there, and not with this wife and sister. But how does it come that a patent for this has not been applied for before by Gabriel? Did your anonymous correspondent explain that fact? It is a point in our favor. You forget our grant was only recently discovered. True, it is about equal, then, ab initio. And the absence of this actual legatee is in our favor. Why? Because there is a certain human sympathy in juries with a pretty orphan, particularly if poor. How do you know she was pretty? Asked Donna Dolores, quickly. I presume so. It is the privilege of orphanage, he said, with a bow of cold gallantry. You are wise, Don Arturo. May you live a thousand years. This time it was impossible, but Arthur should notice the irony of Donna Dolores' manner. All his strong combative instincts rose. The mysterious power of her beauty, which he could not help acknowledging, her tone of superiority, whether attributable to a consciousness of this power over him, or some knowledge of his past, all aroused his cold pride. He remembered the reputation that Donna Dolores bore as a religious devotee and rigid moralist. If he had been taxed with his abandonment of Grace, with his half-formed designs upon Mrs. Sepulveda, he would have coldly admitted them without excuse or argument. In doing so, he would have been perfectly conscious that he should lose the esteem of Donna Dolores, of whose value he had become, within the last few moments, equally conscious. But it was a part of this young man's singular nature that he would have experienced a certain self-satisfaction in the act, that would have outweighed all other considerations. In the ethics of his own consciousness, he called this being true to himself. In a certain sense, he was right. He rose, and, standing respectfully before his fair client, said, "Have you decided fully? Do I understand that I am to press this claim with a view of ousting these parties? Or will you leave them for the present in undisturbed possession of the land?" "But what do you say?" continued Donna Dolores, with her eyes fixed upon his face. "I have said already," returned Arthur, with a patient smile. "Morally and legally, my advice is to press the claim." Donna Dolores turned her eyes away with the slightest shade of annoyance. "Bueno. We shall see. There is time enough. Be seated, Don Arturo. What is this? Surely you will not refuse our hospitality tonight." "I fear," said Arthur, with grave politeness, "that I must return to the mission at once. I have already delayed my departure a day. They expect me in San Francisco tomorrow." "Let them wait. You shall write that important business keeps you here, and Diego shall ride my own horse to reach the embarcadero for the steamer tonight. Tomorrow he will be in San Francisco." Before he could stay her hand, she had rung a small bronze bell that stood beside her. "But, Donna Dolores," Arthur began, hastily. "I understand," interrupted Donna Dolores. "Diego," she continued rapidly, as a servant entered the room, "saddle Jovita instantly and make ready for a journey. Then return here. Pardon," she turned to Arthur. you would say your time is valuable. A large sum depends upon your presence. Good. Write to your partners that I will pay all that no one else can afford to give as large a sum for your services as myself. Write that here you must stay. Annoyed and insulted as Arthur felt, he could not help gazing upon her with an admiring fascination. The imperious habit of command, an almost despotic control of 100 servants, a certain barbaric contempt for the unlimited revenues at her disposal that prompted the act, became her wonderfully. In her impatience, the quick blood glanced through her bronzed cheek, her little slipper tapped the floor imperiously, and her eyes flashed in the darkness. Suddenly she stopped, looked at Arthur, and hesitated. "Pardon me, I have done wrong. Forgive me, Don Arturo. I am a spoiled woman who for 5 years has had her own way. I am apt to forget there is any world beyond my little kingdom here. Go, since it must be so, go at once." She sank back on the sofa, half veiled her face with her fan, and dropped the long fringes of her eyes with a deprecating and half languid movement. Arthur stood for a moment irresolute and hesitating, but only for a moment. "Let me thank you for enabling me to fulfill a duty without foregoing a pleasure. If your messenger is trustworthy and fleet, it can be done. I will stay." She turned towards him suddenly and smiled. A smile apparently so rare to that proud little mouth and those dark, melancholy eyes, a smile that disclosed the smallest and whitest of teeth in such dazzling contrast to the shadow of her face, a smile that even after its brightness had passed still left its memory in a dimple in either nut-brown cheek, and a glistening moisture in the dark eyes, that Arthur felt the warm blood rise to his face. "There are writing materials in the other room. Diego will find you there," said Donna Dolores, "and I will rejoin you soon." "Thanks." She held out the smallest and brownest of hands. Arthur bent over it for a single moment, and then withdrew with a quickened pulse to the outer room. As the door closed upon him, Donna Dolores folded her fan, threw herself back upon the sofa, and called, in a quick whisper, "Manuela." The old woman reappeared with an anxious face and ran towards the sofa. But she was too late, her mistress had fainted. Chapter 7. A Leaf Out of the Past. Arthur's letter to his partners was a brief explanation of his delay, and closed with the following sentence: "Search the records for any deed or transfer of the grant from Dr. Davridge's." He had scarcely concluded before Diego entered, ready for the journey. When he had gone, Arthur waited with some impatience the reappearance of Donna Dolores. To his disappointment, however, only the solemn majordomo strode grimly into the room like a dark-complexioned ghost, and, as it seemed to Arthur, with a strong suggestion of the commander in Don Giovanni in his manner, silently beckoned him to follow to the apartment set aside for his reception. In keeping with the sun-evading instincts of Spanish-Californian architecture, the room was long, low, and half-lighted. The two barred windows on either side of the doorway gave upon the corridor and courtyard below. The opposite wall held only a small, narrow, deeply embrasured loophole, through which Arthur could see the vast, glittering, sun-illumined plain beyond. The hard, monotonous, unwinking glare without did not penetrate the monastic gloom of this chamber. Even the insane, incessant restlessness of the wind that perpetually beset the bleak walls was unheard and unfelt in the grave, contemplative solitude of this religious cell. Mingled with this grateful asceticism was the quaint contrast of a peculiar Spanish luxuriousness. In a curtained recess, an immense mahogany bedstead displayed a yellow satin coverlet profusely embroidered with pink and purple silk flowers. The borders of the sheets and cases of the satin pillows were deeply edged with the finest lace. Beside the bed and before a large armchair, heavy rugs of barbaric colors covered the dark wooden floor, and in front of the deep oven-like hearth lay an immense bearskin. About the hearth hung an ebony and gold crucifix, and, mingled with a few modern engravings, the usual Catholic saints and martyrs occupied the walls. It struck Arthur's observation oddly that the subjects of the secular engravings were snow landscapes. The hospice of Saint Bernard in winter, a pass in the Austrian Tyrol, the steppes of Russia, a Norwegian plain, all to Arthur's fancy brought the temperature, of the room down considerably. A small watercolor of an alpine flower touched him so closely that it might have blossomed from his recollection. Dinner, which was prefaced by a message from Donna Dolores excusing herself through Indy's position, was served in solemn silence. A cousin of the late Don Jose Salvatierra represented the family, and pervaded the meal with a mild flavor of stale cigaritos and dignified criticism of remote events. Arthur, disappointed at the absence of the Donna, found himself regarding this gentleman with some degree of asperity, and a disposition to resent any reference to his client's business as an unwarrantable impertinence. But when the dinner was over, and he had smoked a cigar on the corridor without further communication with Donna Dolores, he began to be angry with himself for accepting her invitation, and savagely critical of the motives that impelled him to it. He was meditating an early retreat, even a visit to Mrs. Sepulveda, when Manuela entered. Would Don Arturo grant the Donna his further counsel and presence? Don Arturo was conscious that his cheek was flushing, and that his counsel at the present moment would not have been eminently remarkable for coolness or judiciousness, but he followed the Indian woman with a slight inclination of the head. They entered the room where he had first met the Donna. She might not have moved from the position she had occupied that morning on the couch, so like was her attitude and manner. As he approached her respectfully, he was conscious of the same fragrance, and the same mysterious magnetism that seemed to leap from her dark eyes, and draw his own resisting and unwilling gaze toward her. "You will despise me, Don Arturo, you, whose country women are so strong and active because I am so little and weak, and Mother of God, so lazy. But I am an invalid, and am not yet quite recovered. But then I am accustomed to it. I have lain here for days, Don Arturo, doing nothing. It is weary, eh? You think? This watching, this waiting, day after day always the same." There was something so delicately plaintive and tender in the cadence of her speech, a cadence that might, perhaps, have been attributed to the characteristic intonation of the Castilian feminine speech, but which Arthur could not help thinking was peculiar to herself, that at the moment he dared not lift his eyes to her, although he was conscious she was looking at him. But by an impulse of safety he addressed himself to the fan. "You have been an invalid then, Donna Dolores? A sufferer, Don Arturo? Have you ever tried the benefit of change of scene, of habits of life? Your ample means, your freedom from the cares of family or kinship, offer you such opportunities," he continued, still addressing the fan. But the fan, as if magnetized by his gaze, became coquettishly conscious, fluttered, faltered, drooped, and then languidly folded its wings. Arthur was left helpless. "Perhaps," said Donna Dolores, "who knows?" She paused for an instant, and then made a sign to Manuela. The Indian woman rose and left the room. "I have something to tell you, Don Arturo," she continued, "something I should have told you this morning. It is not too late now. But it is a secret. It is only that I have questioned my right to tell it, not that I have doubted your honor, Don Arturo, that I withheld it then." Arthur raised his eyes to hers. It was her turn to evade his glance. With her long lashes drooped, she went on. "It is 5 years ago, and my father, whom may the saints assoil, was alive. Came to us then at the Presidio of San Geronimo, a young girl, an American, a stranger and helpless. She had escaped from a lost camp in the snowy mountains where her family and friends were starving. That was the story she told my father. It was a probable one, was it not?" Arthur bowed his head, but did not reply. "But the name that she gave was not a true one, as it appeared. My father had sent an expedition to relieve these people, and they had found among the dead the person whom this young girl, the stranger, assumed to be. That was their report. The name of the young girl who was found dead and the name of the young girl who came to us was the same. It was Grace Conroy." Arthur's face did not move a muscle, nor did he once take his eyes from the drooping lids of his companion. It was a grave matter, a very grave matter. And it was the more surprising because the young girl had at first given another name, the name of Grace Ashley, which she afterwards explained was the name of the young man who helped her to escape, and whose sister she at first assumed to be. My father was a good man, a kind man, a saint, Don Arturo. It was not for him to know if she were Grace Ashley or Grace Conroy. It was enough for him to know that she was alive, weak, helpless, suffering. Against the advice of his officers, he took her into his own house, into his own family, into his own fatherly heart, to wait until her brother, or this Philip Ashley, should return. He never returned. In 6 months she was taken ill, very ill. A little child was born, Don Arturo, but in the same moment it died, and the mother died both, you comprehend, both died in my arms. That was bad, said Arthur, curtly. I do not comprehend, said Donna Dolores. Pardon. Do not misunderstand me. I say it was bad, for I really believe that this girl, the mysterious stranger, with the alias, was really Grace Conroy. Donna Dolores raised her eyes and stared at Arthur. And why? Because the identification of the bodies by the expedition was hurried and imperfect. How know you this? Arthur arose and drew his chair a little nearer his fair client. You have been good enough to entrust me with an important and honorable secret. Let me show my appreciation of that confidence by entrusting you with one equally important. I knew that the identification was imperfect and hurried, because I was present. In the report of the expedition you will find the name, if you have not already read it, of Lieutenant Arthur Poinsett. That was myself. Donna Dolores raised herself to a sitting posture. But why did you not tell me this before? Because, first, I believed that you knew that I was Lieutenant Poinsett. Because, secondly, I did not believe that you knew that Arthur Poinsett and Philip Ashley were one and the same person. I do not understand, said Donna Dolores slowly, in a hard metallic voice. I am Lieutenant Arthur Poinsett, formerly of the Army, who, under the assumed name of Philip Ashley, brought Grace Conroy out of starvation camp. I am the person who afterwards abandoned her, the father of her child. He had not the slightest intention of saying this when he first entered the room, but something in his nature, which he had never tried to control, brought it out. He was neither ashamed of it nor apprehensive of its results, but, having said it, leaned back in his chair, proud, self-reliant, and self-sustained. If he had been uttering a moral sentiment, he could not have been externally more calm or inwardly less agitated. More than that, there was a certain injured dignity in his manner, as he rose, without giving the speechless and astonished woman before him a chance to recover herself, and said, "You will be able now to know whether your confidence has been misplaced. You will be able now to determine what you wish done, and whether I am the person best calculated to assist you. I can only say, Donna Dolores, that I am ready to act either as your witness to the identification of the real Grace Conroy, or as your legal advisor, or both. When you have decided which, you shall give me your further commands, or dismiss me. Until then, adios." He bowed, waved his hand with a certain grand courtesy, and withdrew. When Donna Dolores raised her stupefied head, the door had closed upon him. When this conceited young gentleman reached his own room, he was, I grieve to say, to some extent mentally, and, if I may use the word, morally exalted by the interview. More than that, he was in better spirits than he had been since his arrival. From his room he strode out into the corridor. If his horse had been saddled, he would have taken a sharp canter over the low hills for exercise, pending the decision of his fair client, but it was the hour of the noonday siesta, and the courtyard was deserted. He walked to the gate, and looked across the plain. A fierce wind held uninterrupted possession of earth and sky. Something of its restlessness, just at that instant, was in Arthur's breast, and, with a glance around the corridor, and a momentary hesitation, as an opening door, in a distant part of the building, suggested the possibility of another summons from Donna Dolores, he stepped beyond the walls. Chapter 8. The Bulls of the Blessed Trinity. The absolute freedom of illimitable space, the exhilaration of the sparkling sunlight, and the excitement of the opposing wind, which was strong enough to oblige him to exert a certain degree of physical strength to overcome it, so wrought upon Arthur, that in a few moments he had thrown off the mysterious spell which the Rancho of the Blessed Trinity appeared to have cast over his spirits, and had placed a material distance between himself and its gloomy towers. The landscape, which had hitherto seemed monotonous and uninspiring, now became suggestive, in the low dome-shaped hills beyond, that were huddled together like half-blown earth bubbles raised by the fiery breath of some long-dead volcano. He fancied he saw the origin of the mission architecture. In the long sweep of the level plain, he recognized the calm, uneventful life that had left its expression in the patient gravity of the people. In the fierce, restless wind that blew over it, a wind so persistent and perpetual that all umbrage, except a narrow fringe of dwarfed willows defining the line of an extract watercourse, was hidden in sheltered canyons and the leeward slopes of the hills, he recognized something of his own restless race, and no longer wondered at the barrenness of the life that was turned towards the invader. "I dare say," he muttered to himself, "somewhere in the leeward of these people's natures may exist a luxurious growth that we shall never know. I wonder if the Donna has not—" But here he stopped, angry, and, if the truth must be told, a little frightened at the persistency with which Donna Dolores obtruded herself into his abstract philosophy and sentiment. Possibly something else caused him for the moment to dismiss her from his mind. During his rapid walk he had noticed, as an accidental, and by no means an essential feature of the bleak landscape, the vast herds of crawling, purposeless cattle. An entirely new and distinct impression was now forming itself in his consciousness, namely, that they no longer were purposeless, vagrant, and wandering, but were actually obeying a certain definite law of attraction, and were moving deliberately toward an equally definite object. And that object was himself. Look where he would, before, behind, on either side, north, east, south, west, on the bleak hilltops, on the slope of the falda, across the dried up arroyo, there were the same converging lines of slowly moving objects towards a single focus, himself. Although walking briskly, and with a certain definiteness of purpose, he was apparently the only unchanging, fixed, and limited point in the now active landscape. Everything that rose above the dead, barren level was now moving slowly, irresistibly, instinctively, but unmistakably, towards one common center, himself. Alone and unsupported, he was the helpless, unconscious nucleus of a slowly gathering force, almost immeasurable in its immensity and power. At first the idea was amusing and grotesque. Then it became picturesque. Then it became something for practical consideration. And then, but no, with the quick and unerring instincts of a powerful will, he choked down the next consideration before it had time to fasten upon or paralyze his strength. He stopped and turned. The Rancho of the Blessed Trinity was gone. Had it suddenly sank in the earth, or had he diverged from his path? Neither. He had simply walked over the little elevation in the plain beside the arroyo and corral, and had already left the rancho 2 miles behind him. It was not the only surprise that came upon him suddenly like a blow between the eyes. The same mysterious attraction had been operating in his rear, and when he turned to retrace his steps towards the mission, he faced the staring eyes of 100 bulls not 50 yards away. As he faced them, the nearest turned, the next rank followed their example, the next the same, and the next, until in the distance he could see the movement repeated with military precision and sequence. With a sense of relief, that he put aside as quickly as he had the sense of fear, he quickened his pace, until the nearest bull ahead broke into a gentle trot, which was communicated line by line to the cattle beyond, until the whole herd before him undulated like a vast monotonous sea. He continued on across the arroyo and past the corral until the blinding and penetrating cloud of dust, raised by the plunging hoofs of the moving mass before him, caused him to stop. A dull reverberation of the plain, a sound that at first might have been attributed to a passing earthquake, now became so distinct that he turned. Not 20 yards behind him rose the advance wall of another vast, tumultuous sea of tossing horns and undulating backs that had been slowly following his retreat. He had forgotten that he was surrounded. The nearest were now so close upon him that he could observe them separately. They were neither large, powerful, vindictive, nor ferocious. On the contrary, they were thin, wasted, haggard, anxious beasts, economically equipped and gotten up, the better to wrestle with a 6 months' drought, occasional famine, and the incessant buffeting of the wind, wild and untamable, but their staring eyes and nervous limbs expressed only wonder and curiosity. And when he ran toward them with a shout, they turned, as had the others, file by file, and rank by rank, and in a moment were, like the others, in full retreat. Rather, let me say, retreated as the others had retreated, for when he faced about again to retrace his steps toward the mission, he fronted the bossy bucklers and inextricable horns of those he had driven only a few moments ago before him. They had availed themselves of his diversion with the rear guard to return. With the rapidity of a quick intellect and swift perceptions, Arthur saw at once the resistless logic and utter hopelessness of his situation. The inevitable culmination of all this was only a question of time and a very brief period. Would it be sufficient to enable him to reach the casa? No. Could he regain the corral? Perhaps. Between it and himself already were 1,000 cattle. Would they continue to retreat as he advanced? Possibly. But would he be overtaken meanwhile by those in his rear? He answered the question himself by drawing from his waistcoat pocket his only weapon, a small derringer, and taking aim at the foremost bull. The shot took effect in the animal's shoulder, and he fell upon his knees. As Arthur had expected, his nearer comrades stopped and sniffed at their helpless companion. But, as Arthur had not expected, the eager crowd pressing behind overbore them and their wounded brother, and in another instant the unfortunate animal was prostrate and his life beaten out by the trampling hoofs of the resistless, blind, and eager crowd that followed. With a terrible intuition that it was a foreshadowing of his own fate, Arthur turned in the direction of the corral, and ran for his very life. As he ran, he was conscious that the act precipitated the inevitable catastrophe, but he could think of nothing better. As he ran, he felt, from the shaking of the earth beneath his feet, that the act had once more put the whole herd in equally active motion behind him. As he ran, he noticed that the cattle before him retreated with something of his own precipitation. But as he ran, he thought of nothing but the awful fate that was following him, and the thought spurred him to an almost frantic effort. I have tried to make the reader understand that Arthur was quite inaccessible to any of those weaknesses which mankind regard as physical cowardice. In the defense of what he believed to be an intellectual truth, in the interests of his pride or his self-love, or in a moment of passion, he would have faced death with unbroken fortitude and calmness. But to be the victim of an accident, to be the lamentable sequel of a logical succession of chances, without motive or purpose, to be sacrificed for nothing without proving or disproving anything, to be trampled to death by idiotic beasts, who had not even the instincts of passion or revenge to justify them, to die the death of an ignorant tramp, or any negligent clown, a death that had a ghastly ludicrousness in its method, a death that would leave his body a shapeless, indistinguishable, unrecognizable clod, which affection could not idealize nor friendship reverence, all this brought a horror with it so keen, so exquisite, so excruciating, that the fastidious, proud, intellectual being fleeing from it might have been the veriest dastard that ever turned his back on danger. And suprad to it was a superstitious thought that for its very horror, perhaps, it was a retribution for something that he dared not contemplate. And it was then that his strength suddenly flagged. His senses began to reel. His breath, which had kept pace with the quick beating of his heart, intermittent, hesitated, was lost. Above the advancing thunder of hoofs behind him, he thought he heard a woman's voice. He knew now he was going crazy. He shouted and fell, he rose again and staggered forward a few steps and fell again. It was over now. A sudden sense of some strange, subtle perfume, beating up through the acrid, smarting dust of the plain, that choked his mouth and blinded his eyes, came swooning over him. And then the blessed interposition of unconsciousness and peace. He struggled back to life again with the word Philip in his ears, a throbbing brow, and the sensation of an effort to do something that was required of him. Of all his experience of the last few moments, only the perfume remained. He was lying alone in the dry bed of the arroyo, on the bank a horse was standing, and above him bent the dark face and darker eyes of Donna Dolores. "Try to recover sufficient strength to mount that horse," she said, after a pause. It was a woman before him. With that innate dread which all masculine nature has of exhibiting physical weakness before a weaker sex, Arthur struggled to rise without the assistance offered by the small hand of his friend. That, however, even at that crucial moment, he so far availed himself of it, as to press it, I fear was the fact. "You came to my assistance alone," asked Arthur, as he struggled to his feet. "Why not? We are equal now, Don Arturo," said Donna Dolores, with a dazzling smile. "I saw you from my window. You were rash, pardon me, foolish. The oldest vaquero never ventures a foot upon these plains. But come, you shall ride with me. There was no time to saddle another horse, and I thought you would not care to let others know of your adventure. Am I right?" There was a slight dimple of mischief in her cheek, and a quaint sparkle in her dark eye, as she turned her questioning gaze on Arthur. He caught her hand and raised it respectfully to his lips. "You are wise as you are brave, Donna Dolores. We shall see. But at present you must believe that I am right, and do as I say. Mount that horse, I will help you if you are too weak, and leave a space for me behind you." Thus adjured, Arthur leaped into the saddle. If his bones had been broken instead of being bruised, he would still have found strength for that effort. In another instant Donna Dolores' little foot rested on his, and she lightly mounted behind him. "Home now. Hasten, we will be there before anyone will know it," she said, as she threw one arm around his waist, with superb unconsciousness. Arthur lifted the rein and dropped his heels into the flanks of the horse. In 5 minutes, the briefest, as it seemed to him, he had ever passed, they were once more within the walls of the Blessed Trinity. A long level of dull gray that further away became a faint blue, with here and there darker patches that looked like water. At times an open space, blackened and burnt in an irregular circle, with a shred of newspaper, an old rag, or broken tin can lying in the ashes. Beyond these always a low dark line that seemed to sink into the ground at night, and rose again in the morning with the first light, but never otherwise changed its height and distance. A sense of always moving with some indefinite purpose, but of always returning at night to the same place with the same surroundings, the same people, the same bedclothes, and the same awful black canopy dropped down from above. A chalky taste of dust on the mouth and lips, a gritty sense of earth on the fingers, and an all-pervading heat and smell of cattle.